tester.co.uk.
Hello YouTubers, and welcome to this series where we're going to ultimately create and end up with a variable bench power supply, which I consider probably as one of the most, probably second to a multimeter, probably the most useful item that you can have on your bench when you're starting to do electronics in terms of diagnosis, testing and design. Now, we're going to go down a little bit of a journey, but ultimately we're going to go the full Monty with this project. We are going to start off by testing certain items for this project. For one, when I did the review of the Isotech power supply, the one question people raised there was when I was doing measurements on the output to measure the noise, people were saying, well, why don't you measure the rise time of the switch on? Because that I wanted to add an input output switch on my Isotech power supply. So one of the exercises we want to do today in particular is to see whether just adding a normal DC switch can give that to us, can give us a switch on for your output. Because there are potentially some challenges there. And it seems like an odd place to start with this project, but it could be one of the bigger challenges for me if it's going to be in addition to my college power supply. Now, when I say my college power supply, some of you will have seen this in a video some time ago. I built this, I think, in my first or second year of college when I did electronics. I never did electronics as a career. I started studying it and went off into something else. But I produced this about 23 or 24 years ago. And literally from we were given the circuit design. We, however, had to design the circuit layout. The printed circuit boards were then produced for us at the college. We then had to design and build the outer casing and design the face front and everything else. So I'm going to use this as the basis for our design. Unfortunately, I don't have any of the documentation or project notes from them, which is perhaps not a bad thing, because what we're ultimately going to do in one of the series on from this is open this up, have a look inside. I need to, for one, change the transformer or see if it's got tapping so that I can operate this in the US off 110, 120 volts. As this is designed, was obviously built in South Africa where we had 220 volts. And when we open it up, I'll then note out and sketch out the circuit. The shortcomings on this one is, for one, as I said, it doesn't have an output switch. You obviously, when you switch it on, you get the output live. We want to switch so we can switch the output. We also want to be able to preset the current without having to put a dummy load on the outside. So that's another feature I think this is lacking. Also, the adjustments for voltage and current are a little on the coarse side. So we've got some various options there of either adding multi-turn pots or adding two pots, one coarse, one fine, for each of the voltage of the current. We can then also decide whether we want a digital output or analog. On this one, I've got digital for voltage and analog for current. Now, I think in the process of building this, what I would like to do for myself personally is build one which has got four outputs so that you can both read digital and analog for both your current and your voltage, because I just find I really miss on the digital readouts, I miss having that analog indication. But ultimately, that this project will give you a whole array of options for you to choose what you ultimately want in your bench power supply. I'm also going to attempt and try, once we've got the circuit design, I'll probably use RS Components, have got their own design tool, which I'll note below. And that design tool, I'll probably put the circuit design of this power supply in that. One could either send it off to someone else to get a PC board produced, but I'm going to attempt to produce my own PC board this time, and I'll go through that process. So this really is going to be the full Monty, from literally from our testing up front to see the kind of way we want the power supply to work, to designing it, the outer casing, the PC board, and then having your own various options. So I'm going to bring you in just quickly to have a closer look at my power supply. And then we're going to get down close and have a look on the bench and start experimenting and showing the potential issues with a normal switch and why this is going to potentially add a little of a complication to this design, and I'm going to call on your input for that. Now, this was, as I said, raised on the first video, but thanks to Tiaan for his showing me the potential issues with these switches. Again, Tian's got his own website and has got posted a link on EV blog where he's discussed this issue with these switches, but I'm going to demonstrate it here. Let's get down to the bench. Rightio. So just so we can kind of see what potentially the end result could be, I'll give you a quick tour around my power supply. I am going to open it up as well, again, so we can have a closer look inside. I did a very cursory look quite some time ago. On the front, we've got, I managed to find in an electronic shop, this digital display for the voltage. And then on the current, I had this analog display, which was actually given to us by the college. We were given an analog DC current meter and volt meter, but I decided I wanted my volts in a digital display. We've got these pots inside for adjusting the voltage and the current. The lettering was that old, I don't know if you still get it, but back in the kind of 80s, 90s, you used to get that kind of stenciling where you could use a pencil and push through kind of lettering and fonts onto objects, and that's what I did. And then we did a clear coat spray over the top. It's got the variable output over here, and something to note, someone highlighted as well, that hasn't been done on the Isotech power supply, was they didn't put the outputs at a standard width apart, so you could plug in certain adapters. So that's something to note for the design. It's got the variable output and then a fixed both positive and negative 5-volt output as well. So this is a dual output power supply, and that's also potentially a consideration in the design. It's obviously then got the switch. It's just to move it around. It's then got a little bit of a heatsink on the back, which I presume this is a FET 2N3055. I presume is a power FET for obviously the controls, and it's on the back obviously because it dissipates heat. It's then got a fuse at the back here. Mine's got screw-on rubber feet, and we'll open it up because the PCB is designed, as I recall, in an L shape so that it fits around the actual transformer, which is one of those things we obviously need to cater for, is understanding what transformer we're going to use and how it's going to fit in. You know, if size becomes a critical part of making this nice and compact, because obviously this power supply isn't that compact, then those are certain considerations. So anyway, let me get a screwdriver, get the top off, and we'll have a look inside. Right then, all I've done, I've taken the little four screws which kind of hold the lid on the top off. Let's have a look. Okay, there we go. That's the lid. I say, this was simply bent in a workshop on kind of a bending press machine. I'd never used one of them before, but I say it all turned out okay. Right, so let us come in a little bit closer. As you can see, the reason I thought this power supply might be a fairly nice one for this as a project is that the actual design, there's no complicated digital electronics at all. As you can see, it is very straightforward componentry. It's been a while since I've been in this one. I say I did a cursory look some time ago. The only bit of digital electronics by the looks of things is this IC over here, and it's what, the LM358N, and I, off the top of my head, I don't know what that is. I'm sure people who normally work these things know exactly what that is straight away, so post comments. I'm assuming it's going to be some kind of op amp. That would be my assumption, but I might be way off the mark. So as you can see, it's got a bunch of capacitors. I'll bring you in a little bit closer. It's got capacitors, resistors, power resistor. It really is a straightforward design in terms of what's going on inside the actual power supply. It's got very simple cabling and routing. As you can note, there is a lot of free space in this power supply. So it could certainly be made far more compact once we've got this design kind of drawn out. And as you can see, it's a single-sided PCB, very old school. I mean, look at the spacing of the there is nothing hugely complicated or difficult about this. I mean, you can see the spacing is large, so it should make, I think, for a really simple project. As I said, the one slight complication to this is that switch, which is the output switch, which is what we're going to have a look at now. Just looking at the transformer that I've got in here, we've obviously got the mains input on this side, the primary going in, and then we've got the secondary, and it looks like, again, it's a center tap transformer. And there are two other taps here. So I wonder what I need to do, which I'm going to do in another video, is I will measure off these taps, because perhaps I might be able to get the required output voltage to drive this straight off in the States without changing this transformer, which would be really nice if I could kind of keep it all intact. I don't really want to have to tear it apart unless I have to. So there we go, that's a quick cursory look. Let me see if I can take you in further over here, so you can see all the kind of connections and what have you. It's quite scary. As I've noted, this is probably, besides obviously doing the electronic DC load, in terms of kind of doing fairly nice, neat work, this is probably one of my last examples of that, because I tend to be a little bit Heath Robinson, but nonetheless, I mean, this is what I put together and wired up as my college project, which we're obviously graded on. Right, so let's get down to the actual output switching testing, which is what we're going to focus on today. Right, so let's have a quick overview of the weapons that we're going to be using today. The focus is going to be these two power supplies over here. The Isotec being the one which, as I said, initially drew after the review, the thought was to modify this with an output switch. But we're going to compare the output of this TTI, which has got its own output soft power on output switch, which seems to work quite well. We're going to be using the oscilloscope to take a snap, a capture. We're going to do a single kind of trigger to capture the switch on, so we can see the duration and how clean that switch on is. Now, I have gone and set this up for the most part to capture it so it's all nicely in screen and set up. There's a bit of setup to do that, and that's going to be the subject of the next tutorial on oscilloscopes, is basically doing single shot captures with triggering. It's almost like trying to set up a camera to capture a lightning strike, and that's what in essence we're going to do. Right, a little tricky camera work, but basically what I've got in display is just so you can see the voltage that I've got set on the variable power supply. I'm just going to twig it up so it sits at hopefully around 12 volt. Doesn't really matter. This testing is going to be done under no load situations. So potentially if we did have a load on here, the results would potentially differ. We might have got time to do one of those tests at the end, but let's just see what we get with the switches. So I've got the variable power supply on, I've got the oscilloscope measuring. I'm going to switch the output on, boom, and you'll know obviously the DC line jumps up. I've got it set to 5 volts per division, so that makes sense because we've got 1, 2 and a bit, which represents the 12 volts over there. And in fact, if I get the variable power supply and play around with voltage, you can obviously see how the DC line jumps up and down. Now what we ultimately want to do is, once I'm just using 12 volts as a reference. Now if there's a button down here which I've got my finger on, which is the output button, when I switch that off, boom, the line goes down. When I switch it on, it comes on. And we want to see how clean and the time it takes for the voltage to ramp up from zero to its full output value. And then we're going to discuss what's good and what's bad, and that's where I'm going to need your input, because that's going to take us forward into the next step. Right, so I'm switching the output off. I'm going to set my scope. I've got my trigger set, I think, yeah, so it'll capture, it'll trigger when we switch on. We're going to set up for a single shot, and I'll switch it on, bloop, and we get the switch on and the time, the ramp up of that switch on the scope. Now what I'm going to do, I'm going to switch on the cursors and I'm going to set the basically so we get the duration. I'm picking up the cursor right at the start of the power on over here. That's the 1x, and if we go to x2 and I pull that in, so we get to the top of the wave. I'm going to do it so it's where it stops stepping up on the wave, and we're going to look, and if we look at that, the delta, so the figure we're looking at there is the 10.5 milliseconds. Now what I'm going to do to kind of help and give an idea of that measurement to make it easier when we do comparisons, I'm actually going to link the two X cursors together. So what that does for us is when we then move them, it keeps them together just so we can, because if we do another snapshot, you'll see we're going to capture the wave potentially in another place. So I'm going to set up now for another single shot, output off, switch on. Oh, that was a fluke. It's firing in exactly the same place. Let's just see, another single, off, on. Okay, so we're getting in the same place. But so that looks, and I've done several and it's ended up in the same place. So our time period from when we switch it on to when it's fully on is 10.5 milliseconds, and we can see how nice and clean that ramp up is. So the next thing I'm going to do is switch the output onto the Isotec power supply and see what results we get. Right, I've got the leads into it. Remember, it doesn't have an output switch, so you kind of have to, if you wanted it to switch on, you've got to use the main power switch. I've already got it set to 12 volts. I'll just use the kind of coarse adjustment on it, and you can see how you can hear the relays clicking, how it adjusts. So I'll again take it up to 12 volts. And I've already got the cursors in place, remember, linked from the previous time period of 10.5 milliseconds. So now what I'm going to do, I'm going to switch off the output and I'm going to set up for a single shot, switch it on, bang, and wow, you can see it is the power on. Although it's clean, there's no kind of noise on that, there's no kind of overshoot, it's quite a slow in comparison. Now I say slow, I mean, as I get the cursors, let's just change X1, we've got to take right to the kind of start, which is right over here, and we'll go to X2, which is kind of the end step is right over there. That is heavens, 38 milliseconds. Now I say heavens. I don't know whether that's a good thing or bad thing, and that's where I'm going to ask for input to say, is it better to have a nice steep power on, clean steep power on, or is there more gradual power on? Potentially, if you're testing different devices under test, you may want different conditions. I don't know. So that's what I want to know, because that's what we want to design around, is having a good power on which gives us a good clean switch on, but with a time period, a ramp up, which is good. So now what we're going to do, I'm going to go back to the TTI because it's got the quicker power on, and we're going to see what happens when we add a switch like this, which is potentially something that I was going to connect up to and use on the Isotec. We'll see what effect this has. Right, all wired up and almost ready to go. This is a double pole, double throw switch. So the on, the center is off, and on is on that side over there, if I've got it right. I am switching both the negative and the positive poles. I just need to go over to single shot. I'm going to switch on, not single, let's just go run to make sure we've got the actual output on. So if I go like that, yes. So on the scope you can see, there we go. We can switch it. So now we'll go to single. Wow, okay, so let's just go take it in and have a closer look at that. Right, so as we can see from that, it's quite a messy, it's certainly not that nice clean ramp up that we had, and this is from, again, from the email that Tiaan sent me and what he posted on the EV blog. This is a kind of bounce as from what I understand, inside a switch, a DC switch like that, when you're putting DC through the contactors, this is the bounce of the contactors coming in and then kind of making final connection, as I understand it. Now, in terms of the kind of the period, let's just see if we can measure the actual duration. So if we put the cursors on the kind of start and the finish, 2.6 milliseconds. So that's a nice quick time for between, as opposed to the 10.5 with its kind of soft input, the soft switch on the actual power supply, but certainly a very messy one in terms of that bounce. So this was certainly an education for me and something that we need to be wary of, that you can't just go and plonk any old switch on there and hope to get a nice switch on, because that, if you're doing some sensitive work, could mess up your device under test. So let's just get another example. I've got this very small, cheap push switch with only a single pole. You certainly wouldn't really want to use this. This doesn't handle a lot of current, but just let's see if there's any difference in using a switch like this. Right, so I've got the push switch connected up just to test it. As you can see, it's switching on. So let's set up for a single shot. Wow. Now, can you actually see that? So that has turned into a really nice clean switch on in comparison to the other one. So there's obviously, I presume, a difference in the contacts inside this switch and the way it switches on, as opposed to that kind of double pole, double throw, where it obviously slaps a connector across, a contactor across, and creates a lot of noise and bounce inside, where this is probably a fairly clean switch on, I assume. So it literally is almost immediately on if we look at that square wave. So that's kind of what I want to understand. Do we want a nice steady ramp up or a fairly fast ramp up? What kind of is a good ramp up time? We obviously want a nice clean ramp up, or is a nice square ramp up like this good? Because all this is going to play a part in the design. And if it looks like we may have to design a soft switch for the input to switch it on, unless someone can come up and say, hang on, you can get a good mechanical switch which kind of works well. So that's what we want to discuss. Right then, I hope you found that of value. I say, I'm certainly learning a lot through that process, because I potentially would have blindly just put one of those heavy switches on, which would potentially have a very noisy switch on time. Now, what we didn't look at there was the kind of switch off, to see how cleanly things switch off. But that, if it's critical, we can look at in another video. This is going to be one of those exercises, like with the electronic DC load, which we went through kind of putting a design together, understanding how the design work, doing the case, is going to be a step-by-step process, so it can really get a good understanding on the design and then show the various options that you can add to your own power supply if you want to build one for the bench. This means that by the time you actually get to build it, you'll have a full understanding of how it works. You'll have put it together yourself with your own options, and then if anything goes wrong with it while you're using it, i.e. you blow something like I've managed to do with my electronic DC load, there's going to be far less fear going back inside it to have a look and try and correct it yourself, or upgrading it and enhancing it in some way. So as I said, by the end of this series, we should have a workable bench power supply with its own PCB that potentially you've made yourself, the case and everything else. If you do want to see this series and you're interested, please let me know by giving us a thumbs up, because there's going to be a fair amount of work to kind of progress this and get to the point where we have that end result. Anyway, thanks very much for watching, and I'll catch you soon for the next one. Cheers.
Tester.co.uk